Welcome to another video by Meston Educational Services. This video is going to focus on the chain rule in calculus. In today's lesson, we are going to look at using the chain rule to find the derivative. Now, obviously, we will use the chain rule, as it says over here, for composite functions. Now, this method at times is also called the substitution method. Now, generally, if you look at examination one, the very first question in the non-tech exam, that's exam one, is always the question either on finding the derivative by using the chain rule or the product rule or the quotient rule. So you ought to know these three rules very well. So in the next couple of lessons, we'll be looking at the product rule and the quotient rule. So today we are focusing on the chain rule. Now, as I said, chain rule is used for composite functions. So one of the first things we may have to do is to decompose the function and write them as two separate functions, fx and gx, where gx is going into function x. So the steps involved here, first of all, we decompose the function. Once we have decomposed the function, we find the derivative of both fx and gx. So the function f and the function g, we find the derivative. Once we have found the derivative of both of them, then we go and substitute gx in the derivative of fx. And once we have done the substitution, we multiply the two derivatives, that is f dash x with gx gone into it, multiplied by the derivative of gx. And the result would be the derivative of the composite function. So when I move to the next screen, the example will illustrate that. So I've got over here a function, that's this function here, which is sine of 8x. Now clearly we can see 8x has gone in place of x. So if my original function was sine x, that x has been replaced by 8x. So if I decompose the function, gx will be 8x and the new function hx in this case will be sine of x. So you will see 8x actually goes into x over here. So that's the decomposition that I've done. So I need to first find the derivative of sine x, which is cos x. And then once I've found cos x as my derivative, in place of x, I would be writing 8x, which is the function gx. And then I go and find the derivative of gx, which is 8. So that's the derivative for gx, and that's the derivative for fx, or in this case, hx. Now, what has happened? The derivative was cos of x, but x has to be substituted by the function gx that is going in. So the general rule is you'll take the derivative of hx and substitute gx into that and multiply it by the derivative of gx. So when I multiply the two, I get 8 cos 8x. So we'll be looking at some more examples. So this is the Leibniz notation. We're doing the same question over here. So we are using the substitution method. So we are saying let u be 8x. So that's there. So for 8x, we write u. So then my new function will become y equals sine of u. And my other function is u equals 8x. So I have two functions now. So let's go and find the derivative of this one first. So the derivative of this is going to be dy by du, because my variable is not x anymore, it is u. So the derivative would be cos u. Now, because I have found the derivative in terms of u, I need to write the derivative in terms of x. So where I have u, I need to go and substitute 8x back. So that's my actual derivative that I'm looking for. So it's exactly what we did on the previous screen. So the derivative, that is dy by du, is cos of 8x. And then the derivative of u with the variable x, which will be du over dx, would be 8. Now, this represents the chain rule. So I've got, this is my first part of the chain. This is my second part of the chain. I could have as many. So if I can decompose the function in such a way that I'll have three functions, then I'll multiply it by the third strand. So I've got an example of that nature as well. So dy by du for me was
cos 8x
and du by dx is 8x. So we've just multiplied the two and this is what I get. So this is my derivative for sine of 8x. So I've got another question. Now, first we are going to find a general rule for the derivative. So it's a square root function. And what we've got is a linear function that has gone in. So ax minus b has gone into a square root function. So if I was to decompose this, what I'll have is y would be square root of u, which is, and u would be ax minus b, which is that. So that's the linear function
that I have formed, and that's my square root function y is root u. Now I can easily find the derivative of both of these. So the derivative of root u is 1 over 2 root u. So we have looked at the derivative of a square root function yesterday. Now what I need to do over here is take 1 over 2, and instead of root u, I'm going to write ax minus b, because I want to substitute this back in here. So that's the substitution that I have made there, so ax minus b. So that's dy by du. The next thing I need to find is the other derivative, which will be du over dx. Because it's a linear function, so my derivative is a. So in the next step, I need to go and multiply this with this. So let's go to the next screen. So that's dy by dx would be dy over du into du by dx. So logically what happens is that I get dy by dx. So that's dy by du multiplied by du over dx, which is a, and then of course I can just move this here, so I get that in my simplified form. So the derivative is, now based on this I can find any other derivative. So if I go back a few screens, the question said, hence determine the derivative for square root of 3x minus 7. So if I go here, now all I need to do is to substitute 3x minus 7, so that will become 3, and that's going to be 3x minus 7. So let's go to the next screen and you'll see that's my general rule that there. So all I'm doing is that's my general rule there, and all I'm doing is substituting over there. So for a I'll write down 3 there, and once again for a I'll write down 3, and b is 7. So that's how I would find the derivative using the chain rule. But first I've created a general rule. The same with this example, I've got a 4 over here. The first thing is to take the 4 outside the derivative, because that's a coefficient, and probably you'd refer to that as a dilation factor. Let's take that out. So in effect what we're doing is finding the derivative of 3 over 2 x minus 7. So the value of a is 3 over 2, which is there, and that's ax minus b. So if I simplify that, that's 12 divided by 4, which gives me 3. So that's my simplified derivative. So that's using the chain rule. From a general rule that we created, we could find any other derivative. So if I had y equals 3 over 5 x minus 7 under the root sign, from here I can clearly identify that's my value of a, and that's my linear function that would go in the denominator. So what I would have over there would be 2 or 3 over 5 x minus 7, and I'll have 3 over 5 up there. So that would be dy by dx for me. And of course, I will need to simplify that. So we are just checking this on the CAS. So the CAS gives the answer in this form. So we just want to see if our answer and the CAS answer is the same. So that's our answer and that's the CAS answer. And when I equate the two, it says yes, the two are equivalent. So our answer is right. So in our exam, we don't need to go into that form. We are just okay to leave our answer in that form. But that answer is acceptable for us. This is a simple question here, which is y equals 3x minus 5, and the whole thing is raised to the power of 7. And if you didn't know the chain rule, the general tendency would be to go and expand this out, and we will end up with 8 terms, and that's going to be a very long drawn differentiation process. So what we are going to do is use the chain rule, which is basically very straightforward. So that's going to be my new function. So u is 3x minus 5. So what that does is it makes y equals u to the power of 7. So u is 3x minus 5, y is u to the power of 7. Now that derivative is a straightforward derivative, which is 7 u to the power of 6. And then for u, I'm going to substitute 3x minus 5. So that's dy over du for me. And then I need to find du over dx, because it's a linear function, that gives me my derivative as 3. In the next step, all I need to do is multiply the two derivatives. So when I do the multiplication, that's what I end up with. So it's pretty straightforward finding the derivative of questions of this form rather than trying to expand. So I've just put a caution over there. Anytime you see a high power, it is telling you basically you are not meant to expand. And that's the answer that the CAS gives us. So once again, it's a very similar question, except that I've got root x over there. So we'll still be using the chain rule. And it's very, very similar, except that now my u is this. So I need to find the derivative of that. That derivative will be same as the previous one, which is there. The derivative of 3x is 3, and the derivative of root x is 1 over 2 root x. So in the next step, what we need to do is go and multiply these two. So that's going to be dy by dx will be dy over du times du over dx. I don't need to cancel that out, but I'm just demonstrating the end result is dy by dx. And that's why we refer to this as the chain rule. So it will be dy by du, which is this, multiplied by this. So the next screen will do that for us. So here's the multiplication. We are best off to leave the answer in this form. So I'll go 7 times 3 is 21, and then 7 times this over here. So that's going to be 7 over 2 root x. So I do that, and obviously the other part is this. Now I don't need to simplify or expand the answer any further. So we just need to leave the answer in this form, because what the assessors or the examiners will be looking for is, are you able to use the chain rule effectively? So we don't have to worry too much about the simplification. Depends on the marks that are allocated for the question. If it's a 2-mark question, probably we'll just leave the answer there. So you will see if I did the same thing on CAS, the CAS rationalizes the denominator. So we are just checking. So that's the CAS answer there, and that's the answer that we obtained. So I put the 2 in the calculator. Now I want to check whether my answer is right or no. So that's the CAS output. If I equate the 2, it says it's true. That means the answer that we have is true. The next question, you will see it's 3 substitutions, or rather 2 substitutions, but doing in 3 steps. The first one I'm writing u is 4x minus 3. So that's that part there. And then that becomes log of u for me. So that's v now. And then y is sine of v. So what has happened in this? My original function is sine x. In place of x, I've written log u, which is v. And then for u, we have got 4x minus 3. So we actually get this decomposed function. I could do it in 2 steps, but it is preferable to do this in 3. So I need to find the derivative of that, which will be 4, because that's a linear expression. The derivative of log of x is 1 over x. So instead of 1 over x, this is 1 over u. And then for me, u is 4x minus 3. So that's what I've gone and substituted there. So that's the derivative we are interested in. And finally, the derivative of sine of x is cos x. Now we have to go and put log u, but and then u is 4x minus 3. So that's my third derivative. Once I obtain all these three derivatives, I need to go and multiply them. So in the next screen, I'm going to multiply them. So you will see that cancels there. So what I end up with is still dy by dx. So that was dy over dv. This over here is dv over du, and this over here is du over dx. So 4 times 1 is 4, and that's cos log base e 4x minus 3 and over 4x minus 3. So that's my derivative there. So on the CAS, that's what we get, and our answer does match up with the CAS answer. So another question, find the derivative of log base e 3x minus 7. So once again, a linear function has gone. Instead of using the u and v notation, I'm using the composite notation. So gx is 3x minus 7 now, and hx would be in that case log of x. So in other words, in place of x, I should be having 3x minus 7, and that's what is up there. So I have decomposed it. So I'm going to find the derivative of this, which is 1 over x. But instead of writing 1 over x, I have to go and write this as the substituted function, which is 3x minus 7. So that's my derivative there, so which I have got down here. And then the derivative of gx, so g dash x for me is 3. So I need to go and multiply the 2. So that's what I have done over here, and then just simplified. So that's the CAS answer, and that's our answer, and obviously they match up over here. So you would by now have realized that the chain rule is actually quite a simple method of finding complicated derivatives. Before we move on to some more questions from our log and exponential functions, remember that Euler's number to the power of 1 will always give us Euler's number. So in the log form, what that means is log of e to base e will always be 1. And likewise, Euler's number to the power of 0 or any number to the power of 0 is 1. And what that means, the log of 1 to any base, now in this case base e, would be 0. using the same with base 10. So 10 to the power of 1 is 10, which means log n to base 10 will always be 1. So in other words, what we are saying is log of a to base a will always be 1, irrespective of what the base is. If those two are same, that will always be 1. And then we know that 10 to the power of 0 is 1. Therefore, log of 1 would also be. So we're going to use this. Now, we know this as a derivative. Yesterday, I gave you this as a derivative. And this is something that we are expected to know. So we can obtain it using the first principle, but we are expected to know that part. So if that's the derivative of a to the power of x, you will see it always goes to log base e. And so that's the base multiplied by the original function we had. So what would be the derivative of 5 to the power of x? It would be log to base e into the base value, which is this, into the original function. That's this over here. So that's how we find the derivative of exponential function. So it could be find the derivative of 7 to the power of x, what that would be. So dy by dx of 7 to the power of x for us would be, using this logic, would be log base e, so log of 7 and multiplied by 7 to the power of. Okay, now we can extend this to e to the power of x. So if I'm finding the derivative of e to the power of x, that's what we will get using this logic. Now we know this is 1. We saw this on the previous screen. So 1 times e to the power of x is e to the power of x. And this is a derivative that is very, very important for us. We need to know this. And obviously, you're not allowed reference notes for exam 1. So this is something you should be knowing. Likewise, this is an important result as well. So to obtain this result, this is a derivative that we know. The derivative of log of x to any base, that's a, would always go in this form. So you'll see log base a, and that's Euler's number. So it will always go into that form over x. So if I was finding log of x to base 10, that's what I would get. So that's still log e to base 10 over x. So if I was doing log base 7 of x, what would I get? Log of e to base 7 over x. So now we're going to extend this to log base e. So if that's my question, that's the derivative we get. Now that we know is 1. So the derivative of log base e, x will be 1 by x. Now this one here is once again a very important derivative that we ought to know. This will be used extensively. So now coming back to the chain rule, if I have to find the derivative of a to the power of kx, I basically know that derivative there. So from chain rule, all I need to is to multiply that by, so that's going to give me k times log of, and using that logic, if I'm finding the derivative of e to the power of kx, it's going to be k times this over here times this. Now that there is 1, so what that means is we have got k into e to the power of k. So if I'm finding the derivative of e to the power of 9x, that would be 9e to the power of 9x. So here we have got some examples. So we're using the chain rule. So in this case, y would be e to the power of u, because u for us is 7x. So you find the derivative of this, which is 7, and then the derivative of e to the power of u would still be e to the power of u, but what we need to do is go and put 7x back in place of u. So now we have got the two derivatives. So what you'll have, e to the power of 7x is my dy by du, and du by dx is 7, so that gives me 7 e to the power of 7x. So that's dy by dx for me. So we do have that general rule, dy by dx of e to the power of kx for us would be k times e to the power of kx. So similar question, it's x over 11. That means when I find the derivative of this, this is going to be 1 over 11. So that's that part there. And that there is still e to the power of u. Then I go and substitute that back in, and then I multiply the two. And this gives me my derivative here. Now, this is an additional bit that I have put over here. We know that we can't have log of a negative number. So that there has to be 0 or positive. So So for that to happen, x has to be greater than negative b over a from here. But because we've got ax plus b equals 0, so that means that ax equals negative b, or x is negative b over a. So we are just ensuring that that never becomes less than 0. So the derivative for this would be this, using the chain rule, because what we have is the derivative of, so if I was to use the chain rule, what I've got is log ax plus b. Now that for me becomes u. So u equals ax plus b, and then du by dx for me equals a. And the derivative of the other part would be dy by du for me is 1 over u, because it's log of x, so it's 1 over u. So for u, I need to go and substitute ax plus b back in. So that's ax, so that's 1 over ax plus b, and we are multiplying this by a. So what we end up with is a over ax plus. So a few examples of that. So we are saying that 11x plus 9 should be greater than or equal to 0. And what that means is that would be the condition. So if you get a question of this nature, you have to write that condition there. So now all we need to do is, that's the value of a, and that's ax plus b. That's my derivative. So that's just explaining how we have used the chain rule. So 11x plus 9 has been written as u. So the derivative of this is 11. And then the derivative of log u is 1 over u. But for u, I need to write my original function, which is 11x plus 9. That's what we have done. And then we go and multiply the two. So we end up with the derivative. We don't use this notation. However, if you're doing specialist and you use that notation, that's fine. Because what this means is, if I put it in the absolute value, so these two vertical lines there is saying that this value should always be positive. So you could use that notation. And for it to be positive, we are saying x cannot be negative 7 over 12 in that case. So that's using the absolute notation. So we are saying that is greater than 0. And what we are saying, that is positive. So you don't have to use those vertical lines. You can actually use this notation there. So we end up with the derivative.